This video is mainly for managers and admin assistants. I'm going to be showing you how to designate somebody to set up meetings for you in Zoom and or co-host those meetings with you. I highly encourage you to watch this tutorial all the way through because as of the making of this video, it appears that giving somebody the ability to schedule on your behalf actually gives them quite a bit of control in your Zoom account. So it can be helpful to know what control they will have when you make your decision. Please note that you do not need to give somebody the ability to schedule on your behalf in order to assign them as a co-host for one of your meetings. You can have them be a co-host with or without giving them that additional scheduling ability. All right, first we're going to go over the benefits of having someone schedule your meetings for you, as well as the benefits of having a co-host. Then we'll go into the step-by-step of how to do so. And then finally, we'll talk about what it looks like when you have given those permissions. The main benefit of having someone schedule on your behalf is it saves you a bunch of time. Not only can this person you designate take care of entering all the details for your meetings and set them all up, they can also then generate the invitations for those meetings and get them sent out to the attendees. All you have to do then is go to your My Meetings area and then see what's on tap for the day and click the Start button at the appointed time. It takes away a lot of the legwork. Now let's talk about co-hosting. There are a lot of benefits to having a co-host. He or she can monitor the chat and answer any questions. When you're the host, it can be very hard to try to simultaneously keep on talking while you're also trying to read comments and questions in the chat. Having a separate person to read and respond to questions and any tech issues that come up can make your meeting go a whole lot smoother. They can also monitor the meeting for any inappropriate Zoom bombing type behavior and remove those attendees. If you're going to be showing a PowerPoint, your co-host can do the screen sharing and run the slides for you, allowing you to concentrate on the presentation. They can also act as an extra backup host to get the meeting started if, for some reason, you run into connectivity issues and you aren't able to get into the room. And they can keep the meeting going if your computer suddenly crashes or your audio stops working mid-meeting. Depending on what settings you've enabled in your account, such as having a waiting room or allowing file sharing, your co-host can keep an eye on the waiting room and let people in. And he or she can push out links and documents to your attendees at the appropriate times during the meeting. They can also run the polling feature and pop in and out of the various breakout rooms. They can also clear any reactions, such as the raised hand for questions, yes or no votes, etc. All right, now that we've talked about the many benefits, let's get started on the how-to. Now let's talk about designated scheduling. In order to set up designated scheduling, it requires actions on the part of both parties. So in this example, let's say that I'm a manager and my coworker Alma is my admin assistant. First, I need to go into the settings in my account, and I'll show you how to do that in just a second. And then after I change those settings, Alma has to log out of Zoom and then log back in again. Otherwise, the changes I just made won't take. All right, so let's go through those steps. First, as a manager or anybody who wants to designate someone else to do the scheduling on your behalf, you would go into your Zoom account and then click on the Settings link in the left nav bar. Once that page loads, you'll see that a sort of new mini nav bar has popped up. And you're going to want to check at the top of the screen that you are in the meeting area, not recording and not telephone, meeting. So here, we're going to click in that little mini nav bar area, the link for other. It's going to scroll down and take us to a schedule privilege area. As you can see, I have not yet designated anybody to schedule for me, and likewise, nobody has designated me to schedule for them. Please note that you have to be within the same paid plan as the person who's either going to schedule for you or that you're going to schedule for. To designate your appointed person, you would click this tiny little plus sign and then type in their email address. I'm going to type in Alma's email address. Then I click assign. And now I can see that Alma is on my list of people who can schedule meetings for me. But before she can do that, there's actually that one last step where Alma now needs to log out of her Zoom account and then log back in order for that setting to take. All right, now let's take a look at what Alma will see on her end. First, if Alma goes into her settings and heads over to the spot where we just were, she'll see that she is now designated to schedule for me. And if Alma goes to schedule a new meeting, she's actually going to have a new area on that new meeting screen, right under the place where it asks you if you want to require attendee registration. Now she'll need to choose who she's scheduling for. Is it for herself or is she scheduling for me? If she chooses to schedule for me, then I'm going to get an email from Zoom letting me know that she's done so, and it'll tell me when that meeting is that she has set up for me. Now let's talk about some of the privileges it apparently gives that person when you designate them to schedule for you. When she is scheduling a meeting, Alma can decide to make herself the co-host of this meeting. So now it's no longer up to me to appoint her as a co-host, she can appoint herself. One of the pros of this is that it saves me from having to remember to do so, and it comes in very handy because now I don't have to be involved in the setup process at all. If I'm the manager, my admin assistant can handle all the steps and appoint themselves as the co-host. All I have to do is arrive at the meeting. It's important to know about this feature, however, in case you don't want that person being able to name themselves as the co-host. Apparently, they can name themselves as a co-host to all your meetings, not just the ones they've scheduled for you. And that's because they now have full access to your entire My Meetings area. This is a screenshot of Alma's account. What you see here are all of my meetings, ones that I had scheduled prior to giving Alma the designated scheduling privilege. So apparently, she can now go in and edit any and all of these meetings and assign herself as the co-host for them. She can also start these meetings, end them once they've started, and delete them. Now, this can be extremely helpful if you need your admin assistant to make changes to your upcoming meetings and or co-host them with you. But if you did not expect them to have all these privileges, it's good to know about these before you do that designating. If you'd like to remove those privileges, go back to your Zoom account, click on that Settings tab. The little mini nav bar area will appear once again. You're going to click on the other link, and then in your schedule privilege area, you're going to click the X next to the name of the person from whom you are removing those privileges. So I'm going to click the X next to Alma's email address. It's going to ask me to confirm, and when I click yes, now Alma no longer has those scheduling privileges in my account.